There are a number of reasons to use an artificial grow light. Maybe you don't have the space outdoors, or you don't have the climate that suits the type of plant you're trying to grow. So you want to control the environment and grow it fully indoors throughout the season. Or you may live up in the International Space Station. The reason that I use artificial grow lights is because I'm trying to get a jump start on the season. If you live in the UK, you have a fairly short growing season, especially for plants like chilies. So by giving it a couple months head start, it means that when you do take the plants outdoors, they already are pretty well established and you're going to get much earlier harvests and much bigger plants. You may ask, why not just use a sunny windowsill? Yes, that may work as you get closer to springtime. If you're in the northern hemisphere, you want a south-facing window. If you're in the southern hemisphere, you want a north-facing window. However, the problem is there's not a lot of light intensity getting through. In the colder months, as you get further away from the equator, the angle of the sun is a lot shallower, and this reduces the light intensity. The other problem is there's just generally less daylight during those colder months. If you don't want to watch this whole video and you're not interested in all the technical details about grow lights, and you're just looking for some quick numbers, then if you have a modern full spectrum LED grow light, you want to aim for around 2,500 lux at the canopy of your chili plants, gradually increasing that to around 6,000 lux towards the later part of the season when you're starting to get fruiting and flowering happening. At that stage, generally, you're going to be putting them outdoors into the full sunlight. You want to have those lights on for 16 hours of the day and off for 8. Now, I would recommend continuing to watch this video because there's a lot more information in there. That's a very, very simplified approach, but it will work and you should have some success with that. Let's start off by talking about the light spectrum. It's important to understand that the way that humans perceive light is very different to the way that plants process light. Our eyes are very sensitive to the yellow and the green part of the light spectrum, whereas plants are equally sensitive across the entire light spectrum. This means that the lights that are inside your house that you think are bright and intense are not necessarily as bright and intense for your plants, because light manufacturers are focusing in on a very narrow part of the light spectrum, the yellow and the green, that your eyes are going to most respond to. Whereas plants don't actually use the yellow and the green very much. They're more interested in the red part of the spectrum and the blue part of the spectrum. And grow light manufacturers, they'll tend to have full spectrum lights. A lot of the newer LEDs are full spectrum, which covers the broad range, but it has quite a big focus on the blue part and quite a big focus on the red part. The blue part of the light spectrum is very useful for the vegetative state of growing for your plant, and the red part of the spectrum is useful throughout the life of your plant, but it's especially useful when it comes to flowering and fruiting. This is part of the reason why grow lights might not seem as bright to you as they actually are, and why people sometimes make the mistake of getting their plants too close to the light or turning the light up too much. Next up, let's talk about light measurement. Lumens are a measure of the intensity of light. One lumen is equal to one candle. However, lumens are a measure of humans' sensitivity to light, not plants' sensitivity to light. There's a saying that lumens are for humans, and that's because lumens are far more sensitive to measuring green and yellow on the light spectrum, which, as I just said earlier, is the part that our eyes are most sensitive to as well. Lux is a measurement of how many lumens are falling on a surface area of a meter squared. So if you have 5,000 lux, that means you have 5,000 lumens hitting a square meter of surface. Lux does have some value for grow lights. It'll help measure the intensity of the light and let you kind of gauge where the light should be in relation to the canopy of your plants. However, if you take a red, a blue, and a green light that all have the same light intensity and you measure the lux rating of it, the green light is going to have a far higher lux reading than the red or the blue. So just keep that in mind. Next up, let's talk about a rating that is more relevant to our plants, and that is PAR, or photosynthetically active radiation. PAR is measured in PPFD, or photosynthetic photoflux density. The units of measurement is micromoles, and there are 602 quadrillion photons in one micromole. It's important to remember that this is measuring plant usable light. is measuring the entire spectrum from 400 nanometers right through to 700 nanometers pretty evenly. And it's one of the reasons why palm meters are pretty expensive. Plants respond especially well to the blue part of the light spectrum and the red part of the light spectrum. Blue light is around 400 to 460 nanometers on the light spectrum. It helps with vegetative growth and is hugely beneficial in the early stage of growth from seedling phase. Red light is around 580 nanometers to 700 nanometers. This primarily helps with flowering and fruiting, but it also helps with stem growth, chlorophyll production, and photosynthesis. For photosynthesis, you need to bind 8 to 10 photons with one molecule of CO2. The red end of the light spectrum produces more photons than the blue end, which is why it is best for photosynthesis. How much light do our plants actually need? A common question I get pretty frequently is, how long do I leave my lights on every day? That's the wrong question. We need to change the way we think about this. Let's think of our plant as a bucket with a small hole in it, and the light is the water filling the bucket. If we fill the bucket up too quickly, it will overflow. And if we don't fill it up quick enough, we'll never have much water in the bucket. In the same way, if a plant receives too much light in a 24-hour period, then you're going to end up with an unhealthy or even dead plant. This is kind of like the bucket overflowing. If the plant doesn't get enough light, then it will start stretching, trying to find more light, and potentially become unhealthy or weak. This is kind of like the bucket not filling up quick enough. Bear in mind that leaves have a limit to how much light they can absorb every second. When it comes to chilli plants, if you have a fully mature plant, then the highest I'd recommend, like the absolute maximum I'd recommend for a fully mature plant, is around 900 to 1200 micromoles per meter squared. For optimal growth of your plants during those first few months after germination, I'd recommend no higher than 400 to 500 micromoles. And for your seedlings, very young seedlings, I wouldn't go over 100 micromoles. The total amount of light that a plant receives over a 24-hour period is called the daily light integral, or DLI. This is measured in moles per meter squared per day. If you are going to be growing your chilli plants indoors under lights for the entire season, the maximum I would recommend once they're fruiting and flowering is 40 moles per meter squared per day. For the earlier months, the first few months after germination, I'd recommend no higher than 30 moles per meter squared per day. And for the first month or the first 3 weeks after germination, don't go above 6 moles per meter squared per day. The amount of light that a plant can absorb during a 24-hour period, or the DLI, is affected by things like the health and the age of the plant, as well as environmental factors like temperature, humidity, and even the CO2 level of your grow space. So how much light should we be giving our chilli plants, and how long should the lights be on for every day? Have a look at this graph. It should give you an indication of what you're aiming for. Unfortunately, palm meters are not cheap. However, if you are using a modern, quality, full-spectrum LED grow light, then this graph might help you out. These are readings I took with a cheap lux meter and correlated it with my palm meter readings. So if you go get yourself a cheap lux meter, you should be able to have some indication of what your light levels should be. My guess is a lot of you have your lights way too bright on the canopy of your chilli plants. So either raise them until you get the lux readings roughly where I have them in this graph, or if you have the benefit of a dimmable LED grow light, which I do recommend strongly, then turn it down until you get the lux meter readings. You're going to be quite surprised with just how little light your plants will thrive on. If you are interested in getting a lux meter or even a palm meter, I will leave links down in the description below. Let's finish up by talking about the types of lights that I'd recommend you use to grow your plants. There are two main types that I use. Those are the fluorescent lights and LED lights. So we'll start off talking about the fluorescent lights. These were my favorites in the video I did 4 years ago about lighting. And to be honest, I still am a big fan of the fluorescent style lights. They're not as efficient as LEDs, but the reason I like them so much is the quality of light output that they give is fantastic. The plants love it and they really respond well to it. The second reason is it's very difficult to give too much light when using those fluorescent tubes. which is great in the early part of your season, which is pretty much the only time that I use artificial lighting. But if you intend on using grow lights throughout your season, right through to fruiting, then you might want to consider something else, because the fluorescent lights just won't be up to the task. Let's talk LED grow lights. 4 years ago, when I did my first video on grow lights, I made it clear I wasn't a big fan of the LED grow lights of the day. I thought that they had a little way to go, maybe a year or two, they might be ready. And I also thought that the pricing was way too high. And that's always going to be the case with new technologies. The pricing has come down massively. They are so much more affordable. The grow lights that I have would probably cost about 5 or 6 times as much 4 years ago. One thing I would recommend, if you are going to get an LED grow light, get one with a dimmer switch. This will help you save electricity, even more so than using very efficient LEDs. But it means that you can be more in control of how much light your plants are getting without having to shift the light up and down. You can keep it at a constant sort of spacing from your plants, and you're going to be able to get yourself some very healthy plants. The best quality light output I get is from a cob LED. That's different to your normal LED light panels, because your normal light panel that you may be familiar with, it has hundreds of little LEDs soldered onto a board, and that's driven by like a Meanwell driver or something like that. The cob LED is a single big LED, or in my case, it's 2 big LEDs. And I just get such a fantastic quality of light from that. My plants really respond well. I can't actually find it for sale anymore. And the other problem with it is that it's not dimmable, which means I have to have it very high off the canopy of my plants. I hope this video has given you a better understanding of artificial grow lights. I will be writing an accompanying article to this, which I'll include all the graphs that I've put in this video. I'll be elaborating a bit more on some of the information that I've given you, and I'll link to it down below in the description once it's complete. Thank you so much for watching. I look forward to seeing you on the next video. Until then, stay spicy.